Welcome back to After the Fact. We're now joined by Mr. Ernest Ramel Jr. He's the Secretary General of the Action Democratico. Or are you the
Chairperson?
Chairperson of Action Democratico. Our apologies for that. Good evening, okay. And thank you for joining us this evening.
Hi, good evening to you, Christian, and good evening to all those who are following your program.
Okay, let's clarify some of the issues being thrown against Manila Mayor Isko Moreno, in particular his stance regarding the Marcoses, okay? So, is it fair for people to describe him as someone who idolizes Marcos? That was the term used by former Senator Antonio Trillanes, who of course supports Vice President Len Robredo.
I mean, last Friday, he did say that he idolizes Lee Kuan Yew, Nelson Mandela, Martin Luther King, and to some degree, he liked the vision initially of Ferdinand Marcos. No? But then again, he also said in the same program, in the same event, that the abuses of martial law should not be repeated, should not be copied, like the abuses, the human rights abuses, and the plunder of the coffers of the nation. They should not be followed. They should not be copied. Because he was saying that there are things that you could copy. What were good should be copied. What were good should be emulated. But there are a lot of things during the Marcos era that should not be copied. And chiefly of those are the human rights violations and the ill-gotten wealth, the plundering of the nation's coffers.
But are those good? Are those good things that happened under Marcos? Were they enough to somehow sanitize his image, or to have a better assessment of him, given the atrocities, the human rights violations, the massive plunder that happened under his watch? I think this is the point of those criticizing Mayor Isko.
You know, Mayor Isko is not sanitizing the Marcoses or the image of the late dictator, no. We at Action Democratico have been are with allies with the liberal parties for a long time, and we are also against these atrocities. We are also against the martial law, for that matter. We are also against all the things that happened during those dark years, no? So ganun din naman yung aming kandidato. When we got him into Action Democratico, these were the questions we asked him, and categorical about those things. In fact, he was saying na let the rule of law prevail. Kung may mga kaso, dapat kasuhan. Kung may mga kaso na nandyan sa korte, dapat ituloy. Wala, I won't lift a finger to stop them for or against them. Ano? Dapat lang magtuloy yan, and they be judged according to the merits of those cases.
But why is this the positioning of the mayor regarding the Marcoses? Is it also part of the strategy to basically make sure that he would not unnecessarily antagonize the Marcos base or supporters, because that could also help his candidacy?
You could speculate on that. But then again, BBM is underage. I mean, Bongbong Marcos is underage. I mean, why should you should be careful on not antagonizing them, you know, if the late dictator's son is underage, no? But again, like I said, he was very categorical of those things that should not be followed, of those things that should be condemned. Probably the vision he was talking about was, of course, fixing the landscape of Metro Manila or the infrastructures, no? Initially that was planned for the old country. But these are you could say, the start of the administration. But then again, as he went along, you know what happened in '69 when he got his second term, and it went downhill from there. So these are the things that we are saying that should not be duplicated, and that should not happen at all, and should be condemned.
So can you say that he's not exactly trying to simply court those Marcos supporters to his side by saying those things?
You know what's very important right now? It is to put front and center the real issues. You know, ang issue ngayon is the pandemic. The issue right now is the livelihood losses that we had. The issue right now is the lack of jobs. The issue right now is the burgeoning national debt. Will be, I think, 13 trillion by the time this administration ends its term. No? The issue right now, there are a lot of the, I mean, the inflation. You know? There are a lot of things that could be that need to be addressed. And what Mayor Iscom is saying by just saying move on is to focus on these things, not to just be left behind or not just to put on again over and over this Marcos atrocities and everything. We're not saying that we're not saying forget about them. We're saying never again. But we're saying please let's listen to the 110 million Filipinos right now who's tired of this old narrative of the Marcoses, old narrative of the polarizing BDS Dilawan Marcos. No, let's put our voices together and have the people in government listen to what the Filipinos really need. And these are the basic needs that the Filipinos need right now.
Is that also part of the reason why somehow the unification talks between him and Vice President Lenny Robredo did not prosper?
Okay.
Does he see the Vice President's political positioning as very much fixated on the Marcoses at this stage?
No, he wasn't the position of Mayor Iscom. No? In fact, he agreed he was part of the unification talks because of a lot of commonalities that share, no? In a lot of issues, in a lot of on what should happen to the country. I was really surprised with what happened because as our campaign manager has been saying, during the unification talks, what the vice president is pushing for was Iscom-Pacquiao tandem. Iscom as the president and Pacquiao as the vice president. That's what she's been pushing for. And what I understand, if you're pushing for someone to be the candidate for president, is that you agree with a lot of things. No? You agree with the certain stand or beliefs and principles of that candidate. So that's why you want him to be the front runner. So suddenly, things change. I mean, the last time they had a one-on-one meeting, in fact, no, prior to Mayor declaring his intention to run for 2022. It was days before that they had a one-on-one meeting.
And that was a Monday, if I'm not mistaken. Monday before...
That was the Monday
before he made
Wednesday. Wednesday was his first declaration, that was Monday.
Yeah.
And the meeting was very cordial. The push for Iscom's presidency was still there, no? So suddenly, 2 weeks after, there's a change, and now she's saying that there are changes. Meron siyang medyo pasaring siguro in her speech niya yung mga paninindigan na hindi malinaw, mga ganun bagay. I mean, she's using what in those talks, what transpired in those talks against people that you are supposedly unifying with. Including the so-called Marcos stance of Mayor Iscom, which he felt himself, and he told me that it's not true at all.
So hindi tama yung sinasabi ni Vice President Lenny Robredo na hindi malino yung paninindigan ni Mayor Iscom specifically to the Marcoses.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Just let's make it clearer even further. Does he consider the late President Ferdinand Marcos as a dictator? Maliwanag ba yun?
Yes, yes, he does.
He acknowledges the human rights violations committed, the thousands of people who were forcibly disappeared, jailed, tortured, and killed.
Yes, I caught on with what former congressman and a friend, Erin Tanyada, did say that he must admit to that. And he recognizes those, the atrocities, the human rights abuses, the billions of ill-gotten wealth. He recognizes those.
So he considers this family as plunderers.
Yes, he does. Stole.
Okay.
Yes,
so
if that
is the issue, how can you honestly say that simply that we should just move on? Because again, to be fair to you, there are many different problems that the country is facing now. But even then, the effects of those Marcos atrocities, including the plunder, the billions of dollars in loot carted away by the family and their cronies, we're still feeling that up to this stage. I mean, I think that is the position of people who are criticizing the mayor now. How can you just say na kalimutan na natin yan? away lang naman niya ng mga ng dalawang pamilya. I mean, to reduce the issue simply to a conflict between two families. So, do you think that was quite myopic?
You know what? Probably yung salita move on was misconstrued. He was just saying na kasi he was asked that by a reporter, no, and this is an answer to that reporter. Now he was asked because the vice president said that the reason why she's running is because of your Marcos stance, and he just retorted back that yun lang yung dahilan. I mean, he was saying there are bigger things in play in this election, this 2022. Maraming kailangan intindihin ang bayan. And when he said move on, is that let it not be the center of the discourse. Let it not be the front and center of the issues that should be discussed. Kasi mas marami tayong higit na kailangan tutukan. It's not saying that we forget about the Marcos atrocities. In fact, during that same event, I was there. He said not to, again, say na huwag kalimutan yung pag-aabuso, huwag gayahin. Huwag kalimutan yung pagnanakaw sa kabanabayan ng bayan, huwag gayahin yan. He was very, very clear on those things. And, okay. It wasn't just played on the evening news. What was played on the evening news was centered on the away, no? Yung mga hindi magandang salita na nilaro, no? And I felt that it wasn't fair sa end ni Mayor Scott. No? He was very categorical on a lot of things. Even when he declared for president, he also mentioned those things na the rule of law should prevail and these things na kailangan habulin, di ba? These are the things that also matter, but there are things that matter most. Dapat naman, pakinggan naman natin uli yung 100 milyong may Pilipino na nagugutom ngayon, yung 100 may Pilipino na walang trabaho, may higit 100 milyong Pilipino na merong nawawala ng livelihood. No? Maraming Pilipino na hihirapan ngayon because of the pandemic. And that should be the center of the discourse, not just the Marcoses. But if they want, if the Liberal Party, sorry, just to continue on, if the Liberal Party or the Vice President would like to continue on to make that the center issue, wala nang problema dyan. I understand that nagkandaloko-loko tong bansang to, nagkaroon ng mga systemic may mga malalim na mga problema because of the mark of the 20 years under the dictator, no? So I understand na maraming after effects, but that will be corrected once a new administration with a better foresight, with a better insight to what the Filipinos need govern.
The criticisms that the mayor has been receiving because of his remarks regarding the Marcoses, do you consider this as a serious PR problem at this stage in the campaign? Although hindi pa na officially wala pang official campaign period, although syempre, nakakampanya na naman technically. Do you consider this as a serious issue or problem in the campaign?
I think it's just serious with the crowd that wanted that to be the front and center of the discussions right now. They are the ones serious about this. But what we're serious about, again, is livelihoods, jobs, solving the pandemic, housing, rising the inflation, rising prices. All these problems are the ones we're serious about. If they're serious about those things, then let them be.
Okay, the other issue that his critics have been throwing at him is this question. Another question na binabato sa kanya, no? If he could easily criticize the vice president over a perceived slight directed toward him by the vice president, why couldn't he spew a similar level of anger or criticism toward the atrocities of the Marcoses, if indeed that was his clear position regarding those?
Okay. Again, why should he spew something against them when he wasn't asked, when he wasn't being attacked by or being slighted by this camp? No, they're not attacking the mayor. They're not talking about the mayor. They're not the ones involved in those unity talks. So why he should be directly say things about them, bad or to say bad things about them. What the mayor wants to put back again in the discourse are the problems of the Filipinos right now. And that's what we're focusing on. And if Marcos, Bongbong Marcos, or his followers or his campaign will hit on Mayor Esco, he will answer them back. Definitely.
Okay. So on one hand, you have the Marcos issue as a problem. I don't know whether he would consider that a problem at this stage. On the other hand, the other issue being thrown at Mayor Esco Moreno is the Duterte affiliation or association. He's often described as the secret candidate of President Rodrigo Duterte. In fact, online on Twitter, may hashtag na, di ba, Iscoterte or Duterte Light. What do you think of this characterization of Manila Mayor Esco Moreno?
You know what? It's an early black propaganda against Mayor Esco Moreno. And it's really laughable. Ano? Number one, please, to those who are accusing, whosoever campaign this emanated this from, please substantiate this. Ang lagi lang nila sinasabi doon sa social media is because of Lito Banayo. You know what? Mr. Lito Banayo is a very good campaign strategist. He's a very good campaign manager. He's handled a lot of campaigns, whether it be with Maroas, Tory's time, and so on.
Ping Lacson, I mean, Joseph Estrada.
Or Ping Lacson, you know? He handled those campaigns. And Noynoy Aquino as well. And now you're saying just because Mr. Lito Banayo is with his campaign, he's a Duterte light or a secret candidate of this administration. That's very laughable. I would hire Lito Banayo and times why I would run for a public office, you know. So if that's their only evidence, so to speak, then that's really, really laughable. Number two. Why would Mayor Esco sacrifice for this administration? Where in fact he could easily run and probably unopposed as Manila mayor, the capital of the nation. It would be very easy for him. Why put himself in this kind of spotlight, hurt for not only for him but also for his family, expose his family to this kind of campaign if he's just fronting for this administration? That's laughable. And number three, let me point it out, Action Democratico will not tolerate such things. We've been critical of this administration. We were part of the 2019 coalition, right? If you remember it, with the Liberal Party. We were very much opposed. We did not go for Duterte in 2016. So, malinaw yung Action Democratico will not be part of this so-called scheme that we are fronting for this administration. Come on. Don't you have better things to say? Don't you have better things to do than propagate lies and unsubstantiated propaganda?
Okay, you mentioned Mr. Lito Banay, of course, who is the campaign strategist of Mayor Esco Moreno. But I don't know whether he's watching, but I hope he doesn't get offended with this question. Aren't you giving him too much credit to basically ascribe or attribute that secret candidate criticism simply to Lito Banayo? Because there are also reports that other members of the Duterte administration have been quietly going to the side of Mayor Esco Moreno. And recently, I think there was this cabinet secretary who is now with your group, di ba? Although, di natin siya babanggitin dito, pero let's wait for him to do the announcement. Yung ganyan, yung movement from the Duterte group to Esco Moreno. Not simply Lito Banayo.
But there are also people identified with the Aquino administration who are also, they are saying, part or helping Mayor Esco Moreno. Why are they making light of it, right? Why are they focusing on those who are associated or are associated with this current administration? There are names being dropped all around. I'm sure you're hearing about them as well, you know? And they're not part of this dispensation, but they were part of the administration. And they were a big part of that administration. And yet, it's not there. It's not a part of the conversation. They're not putting it out there just because they really want to make Mayor Esco Moreno appear like what they're saying, a Duterte light or Duterte. Come on. These are clearly black propaganda against a very strong, viable, winnable candidate which probably they don't have.
So basically, that is the reason why all these things are cropping up now against the mayor.
I'm sure.
How you think. Okay. Well, thank you very much for joining us tonight, sir.
No worries, sir. Have a good night.
Maraming salamat po. And before we go, there's more time now to register to vote for the 2022 elections or in the 2022 elections after the Commission on Elections extended the deadline to October 30th. Looking for a voter registration site also just became easier thanks to the new additions to the Sakay.ph app. A new feature called Arturo aims to help aspiring voters locate the nearest registration sites after they input their address. Arturo also provides a checklist that shows reminders before registration. Meanwhile, the Navigate with Sakay feature shows how one can get to the location and also calculates one's estimated fare. The new features can be accessed through the app itself or through its website. So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esguera. You can watch this episode again on iWantPFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the fact.